Hello and welcome to a new video on the CrypTool 2 YouTube channel in the Basics of Cryptology series. This is the second series about analyzing classical ciphers with heuristics. In the last video of this heuristics subpart of the series, I showed you how you can analyze classical ciphers with hill climbing. In this video, I want to show you how you can analyze classical ciphers with help of the genetic algorithm. As in all of my videos in the Basics of Cryptology series, I first show you the What is Cryptology slide. And as we know, cryptography is the art of making ciphers and cryptanalysis is the art of breaking ciphers. And in this video, I want to have a look at cryptology, cryptanalysis, modern cryptanalysis, and classical cryptanalysis. I also marked classical cryptanalysis green, since we use some ideas of classical cryptanalysis also in this modern heuristics, for instance, the frequency analysis. What is a genetic algorithm? A genetic algorithm is a heuristic inspired by the process of natural selections that belong to the larger class of evolutionary algorithms. And the genetic algorithm is well suited for the cryptanalysis of classical ciphers. You will see why on the next slides. And CrypTool 2 has some genetic algorithm implementations, for instance, in the monoalphabetic substitution analyzer and in the transposition analyzer. And we will have a look at both analyzers in the second part of this video. And the genetic algorithm was introduced by Professor John Holland and then further extended by his student and later Professor David Goldberg. On the right side here, you can see John Holland. I took the picture from the Wikipedia. I want to explain the genetic algorithm based on a real-world cryptanalysis problem. And in this case, our problem is to find the used transposition key of a given transposition ciphertext. But at first, we need some terms with respect to genetic algorithm. First of all, we have population of individuals. And the population is, in our case, a set of transposition keys. Then we have properties. With respect to the genetic algorithm, these are called chromosomes or genotype of each individuals of our population. And in our case, these are the values of the transposition keys. Then we have a fitness function to evaluate the individuals. And in our case, this is, for instance, the n-gram score of the decrypted plaintext when we use our keys to decrypt our ciphertext. And the basic genetic algorithm works as follows. In the first step, we have the initialization, and here we generate a set of individuals. In our case, these are transposition keys with random properties. And the number of individuals equals to the population size. This is also a term of the genetic algorithm. Then the main part of the genetic algorithm consists of step 2 and 3 and 4. And step 2 is the selection. And in the selection step, we select a subset of our individuals to create a new population by selecting individuals with high fitness value. So this is a kind of survival of the fittest. Then we generate a new generation based on the selection. So we create a new generation using so-called genetic operators. These are crossover and mutation. And finally, there's the termination of our algorithm. That means that the algorithm stops. And we have different termination criteria. For instance, it could be the number of generations that the algorithm fulfilled, the fitness value of the best individual, the time the algorithm run, and so on. The first step is the initialization step. And as I said, it is a step where we generate a set of individuals with random properties. And in our case, we generate a set of transposition keys. And as an example, I chose the population size equal to 4. In the real world, clearly you use way bigger populations. And we have here 4 different keys. 4 different 10 character long transposition keys. And to make it easier, I did not write it as characters. I wrote it as numbers. In the second step, we do a selection of our individuals to create a new population by selecting the individuals with the highest fitness value. And we rate our keys using an n-gram cost function on the plaintext. These values here are no real n-gram values. I just chose this number that it makes it easier to understand the difference of the fitness of the keys. And our algorithm in that case selects key K1 and key K4, since these have the highest fitness values. So key 1 has 612 and key 4 has 910. So we get these two keys as our starting values or starting keys for our new population. In the next step, we have to create the new generation. And we create a new generation using so-called genetic operators. In our case here, we have crossover and mutation. So what does this mean in case of the transposition cipher? Crossover means that you take two parent keys and you cross over these to generate two child keys. And you can do this for the transposition, for instance, in this way here. We take the left part of the key 1, which is our one parent, and the right part of it, parent, and then we reorder the right part of that parent based on the right part of this parent here, and vice versa. In the second parent, we take the left part here, and we reorder this here based on the right part of the other parent. And you will see how this works in a minute. So first, we order these numbers here based on their position. The first number, the smallest number here, gets the 0. Then the next number, after the 2 we have the 3, gets the 1, then comes the 5, so we get a 2 here, then comes the 6, we get a 3, and here's the 7, we get a 4. And we do the same on this side. So the smallest number here is a 1, so it gets a 0. Then we have the 2, it gets a 1, we have the 3, it gets a 2. We have a 4, it gets a 3, and we have a 9, it gets a 4. And now we generate the new key by using the number of the other parent to order these numbers here. So in this case, here is the 0, so on the second position, we put the value that is here on the second position. So here is the 0, this is the first position, so the value goes here. Then on the first position we have the 1, and the 1 is on this key here, the second key here is a 6. Then we have the 3 here, so at that position we get the value at 0, 1, 2, 3, the 7. Then we have the 2 here, so at this position we get 0, 1, 2, the 5. And then we have the 4 here, and we get on this position the 4, and the 4 here is the 3. And on the right side we do the same. At the same position, at the first position, we get the value at the third position. So we get 0, 1, 2, 3, the 3 goes here. Then we have the 0 at the second position. 0 is 2, so the 2 goes here. Then we have the 2 at this position here. And the 2 is 0, 1, 2, it's a 4. We get the 4 here. Then we have the 4 here, so we get 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, the 9 here. And then we have the 1 at the end, and the 1 is 0, 1, so we get the 1 here. So you reorder the key based on the other parent. This is the crossover. Then we have the mutation, and the mutation means that we, it's like in the real world or with real genetics, sometimes the genes randomly change, and we do the same here by just swapping two random elements of the key. So we just select two elements of the key randomly, the 9 and the 5 here, and we just swap these. And we do the same here, we randomly select two elements of the key, the 8 and the 4, and we swap these, and we get the new values for the key. And our new generation, after this step of the algorithm, is then the first key that we keep from the last generation, the fourth key that we also keep from the last generation, and of course our new key K5 and our new key K6. So let's finally have a look at the termination. And as I already said, we have different termination criteria. For instance, we have the maximum number of generations, we have the fitness value, we have time, and so on. And in our case, we repeat the step 2, the selection, and the step 3, the creation of new generation, until we see no improvement of the best key, that's the key with the highest fitness value for a dedicated number of generations. So you generate children, and you generate children, and so on, and so on, and so on. But you still keep the first key, the best key, it's always the same in each generation. And if we have this a dedicated amount of time, we terminate. And clearly in the case of analyzing a real transposition cipher, our population size is greater than 4. For instance, our population size could be 100. Then in each step, you take the 50 best keys, and based on the 50 keys, you generate the next 50 keys of your population. You could do this by selecting 50 random pairs to generate these. Or you just take the 50 keys you already have and use these in order to generate the second part of your generation. And of course, the algorithm that we discussed here works with fixed key lengths for the transposition cipher. And clearly, with a transposition cipher or ciphertext, you do not know which key was used, so which key length was used. And so to actually break a real transposition, we have to execute this algorithm for different key length. Since we now know how the genetic algorithm works, we will have a look at different analyzers with genetic algorithm that we have implemented in CrypTool 2. I'm here now in CrypTool 2 and I want to show you two implementations of genetic algorithms in our components. But before I do this, I want to give you some ideas why we don't use the genetic algorithm with all our analyzers. And in fact, we experience that the hill climbing approach that we use, or the highly improved hill climbing and simulated annealing, performs way better than the genetic algorithms. So we have only two implementations of the genetic algorithm in the monoalphabetic substitution analyzer and in the transposition analyzer. But in fact, the also implemented hill climbing analysis versions in these analyzers perform better than the genetic algorithm. But nevertheless, the genetic algorithm is an interesting algorithm for cryptanalysis and it's also useful. So let's have a look at these. First, I want to have a look at the monoalphabetic substitution analyzer. I just search for monoalphabetic and then I open the monoalphabetic substitution analyzer. You probably know this here from my video about analyzing or cryptanalyzing monoalphabetic substitution cipher, so this is nothing new for you. But let's have a look at the analyzer itself. And in the analyzer, you see here we have the algorithm, we have hill climbing, and we have dictionary and genetic. And the dictionary and genetic algorithm here is, it's not dictionary and genetic algorithm, it's a dictionary algorithm and it's a genetic algorithm. So they don't, this is not a combined algorithm, these run separately from each other. But let's have a look. So you see here is our ciphertext. It goes into the analyzer. The analyzer instantly finds our key and it returns the plain text. And as you can see here, these are D's. The D stands for dictionary. And then we have the G and the D in the attack type here. This G stands for genetic and the D for dictionary. And using a genetic algorithm, monoalphabetic substitution ciphers can be easily broken. So let's have a look at the other implementation of the genetic algorithm. And this is a transposition analyzer. So I search for transposition. And then I have transposition genetic analysis. And you probably also remember this here from my video about breaking transposition ciphers. So this is also nothing new for you. Let's have a look at the transposition analyzer. So we have here our analysis method. It's set to genetic algorithm. You also have brute force, analysis with crypt, hill climbing and dictionary, but we stick to genetic algorithm. Then we have here repetitions. And the repetition means how many times should the genetic algorithm be restarted. Then we have the iterations, and the iterations is the number of generations that algorithm should create. And then of course we have the key size here, and the key size is the assumed length of the transposition key that was used. As I already said, if you don't know the key size, you have to run it with every possible key size. So you have to run it with 2, 3, 4 and so on. And here we have our ciphertext that goes into the transposition analyzer and our revealed plain text. So let's just start it by clicking on play. And as you can see, the analyzer finds the right key, more or less the right key. It often has problems with the beginning and ending of the plain text. So maybe the right plaintext is in the best list? No. If it doesn't find the right one, you can restart it. And since it's a heuristic, sometimes it doesn't find the correct key, and sometimes it finds it. Now we again, here we have it, the correct plaintext with the correct beginning. And this also is based here now on genetic algorithm. So genetic algorithms are suited for cryptanalysis of classical ciphers. We implemented it for the monoalphabetic substitution and for the transposition cipher. And yeah, this is the end of my video. This is everything that I wanted to show you. The genetic algorithm and our implementation in CrypTool 2. I hope you liked the video. If yes, give a thumbs up. If no, you know what to do. Give a thumbs down. And if you did not yet subscribe to our channel, I would be really happy if you subscribe to see weekly new videos on cryptanalysis, cryptology, cryptography, and of course CrypTool 2. And yeah, see you in the next video.